Jacques, thank you so much for inviting me to your home.
Thanks so much for coming. We got so much information during our trip. I thought it would be nice to go over some of the interesting pieces we had to cut out.
Absolutely. A debrief would be great. You know, there was just so much good stuff. If we had to include everything, the episode would be an hour long.
This is meant to be a supplement to the main episode in Adventures in Genomics.
So if you haven't checked out our main episode, please be sure to check that out first. The link will be in the description below. It was really interesting to talk to Cecil Lewis and Christina Warner at the University of Oklahoma. There's a lot more to metagenomics than I ever realized.
You know, metagenomics is a brand new field that only took off about 5 years ago with the development of next-gen sequencing. And now we realize there's a whole world of microbes that play a critical role in our health and our environment.
And it is even more important to understand now that our urbanized lifestyles are moving further and further away from our natural environment, now that we also have these so-called diseases of civilization.
To me, the greatest insight was that we, as humans, had millions of years to adapt to a hunter-gatherer lifestyle, and that should be our reference. It seems obvious in retrospect, but it's so easy to forget.
And it was surprising just how unique and well-adapted their metagenomes are. I mean, they even have unique microbes that help and protect them.
The problem is that these authentic hunter-gatherer groups are disappearing very fast, and that makes this work so much more urgent. Metagenomics is such a new concept that it is useful to define exactly what it means.
And the term metagenome was coined in 1998, and it refers to collecting and sequencing microbial genes from the environment.
You know, often that is taken to mean bacterial genes, but it really includes viruses and eukaryotes as well.
And yes, and that's very important to remember because bacterial phages play an important role in controlling bacterial populations.
The eukaryotes can include things like fungi, protists, algae, as well as eggs and juvenile stages of some of the larger metazoans. That's code for parasites.
Fortunately, you can get all of those from shotgun sequencing.
Shotgun sequencing refers to fractionating and then sequencing all the DNA fragments in the sample, regardless of origin.
You know, other techniques like 16S ribosomal RNA sequencing, you know, gives you much less information and will miss the viruses.
You know, as sequencing is becoming less expensive and there's a clear benefit to shotgun sequencing, that seems to be the direction the field is going.
The Metsis are traditional hunter-gatherers, whose diet is primarily gathered tubers like cassava and plantains.
The primary sources of protein is fish, with the occasional monkey, sloth, capybara, or alligator, you know, and so on, so on.
And you know, the people from Tunapuco in the Peruvian highlands eat tubers like potatoes, oca, and mashua.
And once in a while, tokosh, which is a delicacy of fermented potatoes that they ferment in wet soil.
You know, it is just amazing that the researchers got such good cooperation from these groups. Without them, this work would not have been possible.
You know, that is a very good point. The researchers worked very closely with the government and also the elders. Cecil also mentioned how important it is that this research should not just benefit the wealthy nations, but also these groups whose lifestyles are changing so fast. The open question is how the microbes moved from one continent to another over a period of tens of thousands of years.
You know, the microbes could have been carried along by the first humans, or they could have been lost and reacquired from the environment.
The test will be if the same microbes are present in human remains or coprolites along the route.
It was surprising that one of the unique microbes would be Treponema. I think of Treponema as a spirochete that causes diseases like syphilis and yaws.
You know, these Treponema strains are not directly related to the pathogenic clades. The closest known member is Treponema sissifaciens, a known carbohydrate metabolizer in swine.
Treponema is also present in the termite gut, so there may be a metabolic role for it.
There is a huge variety of treponemas, and we actually know very little about them. In the coming years, we can expect to learn a lot more about these microbes and the role they play in human health and disease.
You know, Jacques, the point Christina makes about diversity creating resilience is really important.
You know, you see that in the environment as well, in places like ponds and forests, where diversity is naturally maintained.
And the diversity in microbes could also be as a result of diversity in diets.
You know, when you look beyond the things we obsess about in industrial societies, like starch and protein and so on, the difference between the diets really is the hunter-gatherers eat a highly varied diet, whereas the diet from the agricultural group is really very monotonous.
It's true. And, you know, in industrial societies, we have access to a huge variety of foods. And regardless of season or where we live, we tend to buy the same foods over and over again.
You know, that's certainly true when I look at my grocery list. But the foods are also so much more processed.
That's true. But, you know, ultimately, our food also feeds our microbiome. And the solution at the end of the day is up to us.
You know, that's absolutely true. And where this work comes in, if we understand what an optimum microbiome really is and how it functions, it can guide us in the right direction. So the question is, where does our microbiome come from? And that is a very interesting question. In the Middle Ages, people decided bathing was not very healthy, and that did not turn out well at all. So, you know, what do you do?
You know, I know the story about King Louis XIV of France, who bathed only twice in his life. The Russian ambassador said he stunk like a wild animal.
And at the time, the Russians were considered to be perverts because they bathed once a month.
You know, I was wondering, where do you have to draw the line between living in dirt and not washing at all, or our obsessive modern hygiene where everything is sanitized and we'd run around with this bottle of hand sanitizer wherever we go?
Well, the problem with a lot of these sanitizers is that if you read the bottle, they say they will kill 99% of all the germs, but they forget to tell you that they leave the most resistant 1% behind. And that is ultimately the problem. So with all this hygiene, ultimately we are building more and more resistant microbes.
Absolutely. And you know, that is why some of the most dangerous microbes come from the cleanest places, like hospitals.
Now, on the other hand, we need microbes to build a healthy immune system. And you can actually see that with our increased hygiene, there is an increase in autoimmune diseases.
And you know, we have to rethink about our relationship with microbes. They're not all good, but they're not all bad either.
You know, we've had an intimate relationship with our microbiome for millions and millions of years. Now, finally, we have the tools to understand this relationship better and to build a healthier relationship with our microbiome.